Forget about yourself. Concentrate on Him and worship Him. So forget about yourself. I know there's a lot going on, but concentrate on Him and worship Christ our Lord. Hallelujah. Worship Him, Jesus Christ our Lord. Jesus Christ, Jesus Christ our Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Holy Ghost. For we know that in the presence of God, there is fullness of joy. And at His right hand are pleasures evermore.
Give Him glory. Give Him glory. We come to do our dance and give Him praise. Give Him glory. We come to clap our hands. We come to lift our hands and give Him praise. Give Him praise. Hallelujah. Give Him praise.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Oh, Father, we thank You, Lord God, that we're able to give You praise, oh God. We come to adore Your name, Lord God. We come to worship You, for You deserve all the glory.
Amen.
Yes, Lord.
Amen.
Forever.
The
gave to us, Lord, and we freely share with this world we live in. Hallelujah.
Bring all your failures, bring your addictions, come lay them down at the foot of the cross. Jesus is waiting, God so loved the world.
Hallelujah. We thank you, Lord, for your great love, Lord God. We thank you, Lord, because you put your love in us, Lord God, we can share that same love with one another. We thank you, Father God, that the love of God has been shared abroad in our hearts through Holy Spirit. I just want us for a little while, amen. Can we just walk around, shake a hand, hug a neck, praise God, and let's just invite, let's welcome, Lord God, let's welcome people here in the name of Jesus, amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Good morning.
Hallelujah. We want to welcome our Facebook family. God bless you. We thank you for tuning in today. God has a word for us today. Amen. And we just thank God for Pastor Eddie. We thank God for this church. We thank God for you today. Hallelujah. That's it, people of God. Love on and hug a neck. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus.
Yeah, my friend. That's my baby right there.
Oh, that's it, people. The God love on one another. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
Returning to our seats this morning, we will have a short skit facilitated by Brother Derek Porter and Brother Cyrus Pickett. So if I could call your attention and ask if we could go ahead and take our seats, we'll now turn it over to Brother Derek Porter and Brother Cyrus Pickett.
Lord, I'm going to need you to bless me with another bed because that hurt, Lord. I'm not getting no good sleep. I need another mattress, Jesus. Well, anyway, first of all, Lord, I want to just thank you for waking me up to see another beautiful day. Thank you for all you've ever done for me, Lord God, for watching over me throughout last night. Let no harm coming to me or my family. And now, Lord, as I get up and prepare for this day, I pray that you just guide me safely, Lord God, to my destination, to working back, not only myself, but my family. And then, Lord God, if it should be someone, Lord God, that should need to hear the gospel, I pray that you would just give me the right words to say, Lord God, that they not come from me, but from you. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen, amen, and amen.
Ring, 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 ring.
Hey, Doc, what's up?
Hey, Brother Cyrus. Your test results are back from the test we took last week, and I'm afraid the news isn't good. I've got some pretty bad news.
You sure you got bad news on me? Can you check your charts again, Doc, to see you got the right charts? I mean, this is Cyrus Jerome Pickett Sr. You sure you don't have him mixed up with someone else? I mean, I don't understand.
I know, brother. I've been through the charts. I just hate to tell you this. I reviewed the records over and over again. I triple reviewed them before I gave you this news. Is there anyone you can talk to? Like, do you have any family? What about a faith family?
No.
What about a priest, a pastor, a rabbi? Is there no one?
No, it's just me. I don't understand. I lived a good life. I done what I was supposed to do. I pay my employees well. I give generously. I do all those things that I was supposed to do. I just don't understand. Why me? Lord, I remember growing up. I remember hearing mama and grandma talk about God and church and religion, but I didn't believe any of that stuff. I thought it was all just a hoax. I really didn't understand. I know y'all took me to church, but I wasn't paying any attention. I just went for the desserts and to flirt around and do all those other things. But after hearing this bad news, Lord, after getting off the phone with my doctor, I don't understand why. What must I do? I can't do this by myself, Lord. I need you to show me the way. Lead me and guide me, Lord. Send somebody. How do I become a Christian, Lord? I don't know how I would live my life from this point on without knowing you, Lord, but I just don't know how to reach out to you.
New, everything new. Oh. Good morning, Mr. Big. How you doing?
Good morning, Derek. Okay. I'm fine.
Okay.
Derek, that's the one?
No.
That's you, the one, Derek?
You tripping, Lord. I know you tripping. You tripping.
You asked me to show you. That's the one that needs you.
This man don't even talk to me, for real.
But he's the one I'm sending your way today.
Yes, Lord. Okay, God. Mr. Pickett.
Yes.
Can I talk to you for a moment? I know you're busy and everything.
I really don't have time. I got other things to do. I'm trying to run a company. I mean,
I understand that, and I know you really don't talk that much and stuff like that. But you know, I pick up people by the language, and when you walk by me just then, some said that something I write in your spirit, and so I'm not trying to get in your business or nothing like that. But
okay, just a moment. I got other things to do. What's up?
So, is something bothering you? Something troubling you?
Well, I just received some bad news from my doctor, and I just, you know, it's a shock to me, and I just don't know what to do. I mean, I don't know, man. I just don't know right now.
I mean, I get that, and that's a common thing. And I know people look at doctors and they say, you know, saying they really intelligent, could they operate on the body, but the doctor didn't create you, though. I'm not going to say the doctors are not necessary, because they are. And what I'm about to say may not be company related, nothing like that, but at the end of the day, I feel like it's way more important than the company, because
more than important than the company?
It's what I believe in. And the truth of the matter is, your employees that come here, they believe in the same thing, and that's what makes them good employees. Because I believe as whatever I sow, I'm going to reap. If I ever want to have my own, I got to be a good employee. So, yeah, I do so. And that's by God, to be honest with you.
By God.
And that's, I know people say God.
Here we go again.
Okay. Give me just a couple minutes.
Okay.
You used to drive trucks, right?
Absolutely.
Okay. Now, when you were driving those trucks, well, first of all, you believe that the wind existed, right?
Yeah, sure. Yeah, of course.
Okay, now, we're going to go for a minute. When you were driving those trucks and the wind was blowing heavy, mm-hmm. it would hit that truck, right?
Walking left and right.
But you couldn't see it, though.
Couldn't see it at all.
But it was there, though, right? Well, you believe that it was there.
Oh, absolutely.
So even you ain't got to see nothing to believe that it's there.
I see your point.
Okay, so I know we can't see God and like that. You know, you meet some people and they be like, oh, hallelujah, thank you, Jesus. And you're like, man, I ain't got time for that. And some people do that and they're serious. They really believe that way. But you ain't got to talk to God that way. Mm. Just like you're talking to me. You know what I'm saying? And I know a lot of people that went to church with their grandparents, but then they got older, you know, and they were just going because it was taking it. And I'm not going to lie to you and say I didn't go through that, because I did. My freshman year in college, I'm sitting thinking about if I was in Africa, would I be, you know, saying a Muslim or a Moor and stuff like that. And then I had to think to myself, when I was a kid, I ain't never called on Buddha or Confucius. The only person I ever called on was Jesus.
Mm.
So I'm not asking you to necessarily confess Christ now, you know what I'm saying? But the Bible said, you know, saying that faith is the substance of things hoped for. Some people say that substance means confidence. So my thing is, even though you can't see him, you can still try. As a matter of fact, if you didn't try everything else, you didn't try the doctor, they done told you, gave you the bad news, well, what am I going to do?
You're right. Tell me more.
So my thing is, when you get a chance, you go home, you got this right here, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so you can Google the road to salvation and everything. You're going to say, for all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, but the wages of sin is death, and those things are true. So you can, it's going to show you certain things, but even then, you still need answers. So I'm here if you want to talk, you know what I'm saying? You not even necessarily me, but I'm here. It can just be me and you, just one-on-one, whatever the case may be. But my thing is, try him and see. Just try them and see. I'm not going to say it's going to be easy, but before you start driving trucks, you studied.
Right.
For that road test.
Yes, absolutely.
Okay. It took some time. When you got in that truck and you was driving, you had to learn how to maneuver that truck to back it up and everything.
Right.
All I'm asking you to do is try God.
Mm. Well, at this point in my life, everything else seemed to fail. And I don't know where else to turn, so I guess I will try.
I'm telling you, man.
You said the road to salvation.
The road to salvation. And at the end of it, only thing, a lot of times you go to church, people say, no, you know what I'm saying, confess to your heart, believe, you know what I'm saying, that he is Christ the Lord and, you know, and save me. All I'm asking you to say is, when you get to that point, because faith is, you don't start out with a bunch of faith. I don't care what bishop you see on TV, he didn't start out with all that.
Mm, okay. So you know, just pray and
like you talking to me.
Talk to God now? Like sure, I would love to, man.
Well, like I said, we're gonna keep it simple.
Okay.
Like I said, we're not gonna get all into quoting a bunch of scriptures.
Okay.
So, do you know specifically? I'll tell you what, let's pray. The Lord, I just thank you, Lord God, for this time to be with, you know what I'm saying, my brother. Even though he's not confessing you yet, Lord, I already know he gonna confess you, Lord God. For my brother Cyrus, for Mr. Pickett, I pray, Lord God, that whatever is troubling me in the spirit, Lord God, I know that you already know. As a matter of fact, it's you, Lord God, that brought us to this moment. And I pray, Lord God, that you allow your Holy Spirit to enter into him, Lord God, and that you deliver him from whatever is troubling him, Lord God. And even if you don't, I know that you're able, Lord God. I pray that you give him strength and courage, Lord God, to go through this and know that even though he didn't know you was there, you were always there. You brought him to this moment. You brought him when he was driving trucks on the road, Lord God. Brought him through accidents. You covered him then. And let him know, Lord God, you're going to cover him now. I thank you, Lord God, for what you're going to do in advance. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Thank
amen.
You, Brother Derek. Lord, thank you. Derek, can I be earnest with you, brother? When you first approach me and start talking about church and God, I start to fire you on the spot because you know the policies. We don't bring Bible into my company. All that stays outside in the world. But now I thank God for leading you, bringing you to me. And I have confessed my sins unto the Lord. He have forgiven me. And he told me that when I die, I will have eternal life. No matter what the doctor says on this side of the world, he have placed in my heart the concern that I know now that there is another life outside of this life. You know what, Derek? Not only do I thank you, but because you shared your faith with me, since you have led me to God, know God for myself, you see this office space here in the corner? I'm promoting you, man. I'm promoting you because you have shared to me. And for that, I'm going to give you a raise comes with it. A company card, credit card. Derek, I want you to be my right-hand man. Because I see things in you that I didn't see before. Now that I believe that you and I will learn to share God with others as well. Thank you, my brother.
Thank you, God.
I appreciate you.
Hey, because you're going to buy me every day then. Because you hear me every day. I'm
bless
trying to
you,
tell
brother.
You. But I thank you, though. Thank you, thank you, thank you.
Amen. Thank you, brother, Minister Derek and Minister Cyrus. As the praise and worship team comes back up, I'm sorry, we're scripture reader, right? I just want to remind you of Romans 10:9 that says, if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. And amen. We'll now have Mother Mary come up for scripture reading.
Good morning.
For God so loved the world.
Yes.
Whosoever
believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life.
Yes.
That's for everybody.
So, our scripture reading today is going to be St. John, the first chapter, and we're starting at verses, and my phone just doing its own thing. 35, yeah. My apologies, you know. Okay, I'm ready. Yes, yes, sir. Thank you. Okay, so I'm going to start reading verse 35, and then the responsive verses, you will read 36, and we go back and forth. And the last verse will all come together, okay? All right. Verse 35 says, the next day John was there again with two of his disciples. When the two disciples heard him say this, they followed Jesus.
Turning around, Jesus saw them following and asked, what do you want? They said, Rabbi, which means teacher, where are you staying?
Come, he replied, and you will see. So they went and saw where he was staying, and they spent that day with him. It was about 4 p.m.
Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, was one of the two
who heard
what John said
and followed
Jesus.
The first thing Andrew did was to find his brother Simon and tell him, we have found the Messiah, that is the Christ.
And he brought him to Jesus. Jesus looked
at
him and said,
you
are Simon, son of John.
You will be called Cephas, which when translated is Peter. And verse 43 altogether, the next day, Jesus decided to leave for Galilee.
Yeah.
Okay. The next day, Jesus decided to leave for Galilee, finding Philip. He said to him, "Follow me."
Amen.
Oh, praise the Lord. Amen. We make ourselves available to our God. Hallelujah. He will use us. All we have to do is just make ourselves available.
Amen.
Just ask him. And this is Derek's life. This is what Derek does on his job. Praise God. Mm-hmm. And praise God. Look for that office, that corner office space. Amen. Mm-hmm.
Amen.
Let us continue to worship the Lord this morning.
Will I give to you? I'll do what
BRCC.
Be ready.
It is good to see all of you. Let's give Jesus some praise in the house. It's a wonderful day. Glad to see all of you. We are glad to see Miss Lee. Miss Lee, wave your hand. There you go. You know, so if you had doubt about why Miss Lee has been out, we didn't fire her. Amen. God just changed her assignment, but she's still part of the family. Amen. She's in touch. She's sending all the text messages.
Said, and we had the rehearsal the other night. There's no place like home.
Yeah, you go. And that's what, you know, means when you're serving Christ, you know. The Lord has assignment for all of us everywhere we go. Yeah. One day you are here. Some days he sends you to the other place. And then when you come on back, you know, you can fellowship, embrace each other. So we are glad to see you.
Amen.
Please extend our thanks and appreciation to Pastor Rachel Lynn Strecker. Yes. You see, Miss Lee is really blessed. She served, worked with two pastors who are originally from Liberia. You know what I'm saying? So when she comes here, she gets the accent, and then she goes back there and get the attitude over there. But we are glad to have you back. It's good to see all of you. Patricia, right? There you go. She'd be like, you forgot my name? No. She's our neighbor right across the street. Neighbor across the street. It's good to see you. There's a brother sitting right there by First Lady, Matthew. Brother Matthew, yeah, Alfred introduced him to me. But we're glad to see you. Thank you, Cyrus and Derek, for the skit, and Miss Tracy. Thank you for that. You know, we just want to be able to communicate the gospel, you know, the best way possible so we can all, you know, be able to share so others can hear the message. Yeah, BRCC, you know, we like to read, you know, reading is a good thing. So we've been reading in The Insanity of God. We're going to come to that. I think in May, Reverend Stone said that we're going to be studying this book, go a little deeper on Wednesday. But in the meantime, we're still in profiles and character. And I tell you, Wednesday night, we talk about Amos. It was interesting, moving. So I encourage you to read, you know, stay on top. And let God equip you. We say we want to be ready for the coming of Christ, right? And that's one way we can get ready to search the book, you know, search the scripture, you know, share, get in touch with what other people are saying, what they're doing, so that we will know how to share our faith. This quarter year at BRCC is our season to witness. Our season to witness. Jesus said, go and make disciples of all nations. Preach the gospel wherever you go, whenever you have time. And that's what we want to encourage ourselves to do. We want to remind ourselves as a believing community. We want to teach people how to do it. We want to ask folks to develop the courage. It's not easy to tell somebody about salvation. Who gave you the right to go tell someone that their life is messed up? Mm-hmm. So you need Jesus.
Yes.
How do you know?
Yes.
So we pray that God will help us learn how to do that with love and with grace. We want to welcome our Global Faith family, the many of you who are not in the room today but are worshiping with us. in different places. I know Miss our own dear sister Viola is watching. Cheryl Gunn is watching. Of course, Pam is always there. Miss Annie from Louisville is there. Minister Diane Kennedy, we know you are there. Karen Lazy, you are there. Mariana, Roger. I mean, the list goes on. So we say thank you for worshiping with us. You make us know that we're here for a purpose. We also want to say to those of you who are in the Birmingham area, you know, we want to invite you to come and fellowship with us. We want to see you. We want to feel you. You know, we want to know you are there. It's good to worship online, but you know, there's something more than just coming in the house. And, you know, your presence encouraging other believers. We know Victoria is there. Fei, you know, we say, welcome to BRCC. We want to be ready for the coming of Christ. And one of the ways we do it is to witness. Two Sundays ago, we shared from Acts chapter 1, verse 8. Jesus said, you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you. Yeah. It's like you go to work, and when the pay period comes, you receive a check to pay your bills. You can't take that check and put it in the bank and just say, well, let it sit there and Alabama Power will know, Trust for God. No. Penny Mac, they want you to issue a check. Yeah. So now you have the Holy Spirit. If you just keep it, you know, put it in the box and sit on it, it's not going to work. He said, get out there and let the Spirit work in and through you. As you walk, as you go, the Spirit will talk to you, speak to you. As you commune with God, the Holy Spirit will enable you to sense that somebody has a need, that somebody needs prayer, that somebody needs a smile, that somebody needs a piece of cornbread. You know, Jesus said, give a cup of cold water in my name. So why do we have the Holy Spirit? To witness, to share a testimony that I was once a sinner. Jesus came, he forgave me, and now I have eternal life. That's why he said, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. Whosoever believes shall not perish, but have everlasting life. How did you get to know about Jesus? Who was it that first told you? For some of you, it was your grandma, some was your auntie, some your uncle, your dad, your mom. And I want to say from the start, as we read in John chapter 1, Andrew going to find his brother, that's what our emphasis will be today, about reaching those who are closest to us, who are dearest to us. Those are the most difficult group to talk to about Jesus. Those who stay in the same house, under the same roof, they know how I behave. They know when I'm joking and I'm serious. They know everything about me. They know my past. But we need not leave them out. Why do we share? Why should we share? Because you care. Yeah. It's like someone said, if you're passing down the road and there's a house that is on fire, The house is on fire. You know there's somebody in that house. It could be an elderly person or a baby. The house is on fire. You have your cell phone and you can call 911 to come and help save somebody. What will you do? Or say, oh yeah, I'm on my way to work. What will you do if the house is on fire? And you were the only hope to make it possible for somebody's life to be saved. The Bible says God sent not his son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. Those who accept Jesus, the Bible still teach, will have eternal life. Those who reject Jesus, the Bible says they will be eternally separated from God. When you read Revelation, it says those who are ungodly in this world, their place will be the second death. The lake of fire. I did not say so. In my own mind, my own thinking, I would never ever wish anybody to be burned in fire. But that's what the Bible says. How dangerous it is when we don't have a connection with God in this word. So in John chapter 1, the scripture we read today, it says that when Jesus came on the scene to preach and teach, John the Baptist was already preaching.
John was preaching and Israel was looking for a redeemer. When you go back to the Bible, God made a promise long time ago when Adam and Eve disobeyed, when Adam and Eve sinned, when Adam and Eve were thrown outside of the garden that God had created. And God made provisions that one day the relationship will be breached. So through many generations from Abraham, God said, leave home. I will bless those who bless you. Through you, all people of the earth will be blessed. Come Isaac and Jacob and Joseph in Egypt. And God's preparing the global community for this reunion, for this reconciliation. Through many generations, God will prepare. He sent prophets. He sent teachers. Like Isaiah would say, for unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government will be upon his shoulder. He will be Prince of Peace. And that the Messiah will be born in Bethlehem. So God is not just, you know, speaking randomly through people. God has a plan to bring healing to the broken universe. And so when it's time, when John is preaching, of course, in Palestine, in Jerusalem, in Israel, Rome is there, occupying the land. And how can we compare that today? It's you go to Gaza. There's no life there right now. It's death and destruction. There's human stench in the air because of the war. Mm-hmm. Or you go to Ukraine, same thing. When winter was coming, Russia targeted all of their power grids to punish them because they want to align themselves with NATO. That's war going on. You see, the world in which we live, there is pain and suffering. Yeah. I was watching the TV and looking at refugees from Sudan. About 8,000 people, women and their children displaced. Djibouti, all over this global community, there's pain and suffering. Why? Because somebody wants to make the mighty dollar. When I first came to America, I went to Beeson Divinity School, and a lot of wonderful Christian people would go to church, and, you know, they'll come and, oh, you're from Africa? Yes, oh, blah, blah, blah. No, why you're African like to fight? And I said, be careful what you ask for, because I can tell you straight what I know. See, in Africa, we don't make bullets. We don't make guns. We don't make missiles. We don't make a RPG. No. Somebody makes them in order to make money. And in order for the RPG and the AK-47 to sell, you have to create conflict somewhere. I said, you want to hear me talk some more? So we are crazy, but we are not that crazy. We love life. We love our family. We love our children. We don't want to see people being displaced, split up. But this guy who's creating all of this, he gets home in the evening to his wife and children, and they sit at the dinner table, put the filet mignon and whether tilapia or salmon, whatever you choose. He said, honey, business is good. Business is good at the expense of a family that got separated. Mother got killed. Baby will never see her mom again. And that's why, you know, we're reading the insanity of God. Read that. You know, when I look at what's happening in Sudan, I kind of talk about Somaliland quickly. Then you come home to Birmingham. There was a missionary couple in the 70s. They were in Beirut, you know, Lebanon, when the war was raging there. And they came on furlough, and he was anxious to go back to Beirut with his family, with his children. And some family members said, why would you want to go to that place when there's war going on? He said, honey, I know. He said, the war that's going on in Beirut, I can hear the sound of the bullets. And know which direction it's coming from. At night, I can sit on my porch and I know which way the bullets are being exchanged. He said, but the war that's going on in America, You can't see it. There's drug war going on. Don't take for granted that the drugs that are in the street are just there because some Christian kids want to use drugs. It's intentional. Marijuana business, who's behind it? The Chinese. Fentanyl is killing our young people. If you want to destroy a nation, then you touch their mind. Disorient them, then you will know that they become nothing. So there's a lot of crises, but we need help. The world needs hope, and that's where Jesus comes in. The world is on fire, folks. And Jesus said, we are the light, we are the salt. So it says in John chapter 1, verse 35, John is preaching, and Jesus is on the shore. And two of his disciples are following him. And he sees them. And the Bible says he points to Jesus. He said, this is the Messiah we're looking for. And then verse 37, turning around, Jesus saw them following him. He said, what do you want? They said, teacher, we want to know where you stay. He said, come. So they went to stay with Jesus, spend a day with Jesus. Yeah. Spending a day with Jesus brings peace. Spending a day with Jesus brings comfort. Spending a day with Jesus gives you clear direction in your life. So when they spend the time with Jesus, no telling what the conversation was. You know, they listen and Jesus introduced himself and said some wonderful things like John said that are now written in this book. So, and when they left, Andrew made up his mind. He said, hey, brother, have any of you seen The Chosen, the television series? Oh, yeah, I love it. I like the way they humanize people in the book. Yeah. So verse 41, the first thing Andrew did, Andrew was like a beggar. They said, believers, evangelists, we are beggars who are going out there in the streets to look for food. We found it, and we want to take it back home to those we left behind. There's a story in, I think, Chronicles, where those two lepers at the gate of the city. Yeah. And the army of Samaria, the people ran away and left food. When they found bread, they said, no, we can't just sit here and eat and have feast. There are people behind in the fence. People behind us, they need food. If we sit and just feast and enjoy ourselves, it'll be a sin. We need to go back to the city. And one of them said, you know, we are lepers. You know, if we go, they'll kill us. If they kill us, it's up to them. But we need to share this good news. Amen. And that's what the gospel is. Good news. Good news, good news. So I say, the first thing Andrew did was to find his brother Simon and told him, we have found the Messiah. What if Andrew had not told his brother? You know, this brother became the leader of the church, right? You know, when Jesus was about to leave, he left the church with Simon. But it was all because Andrew brought him. So it's important, family, that in our, especially for people like me who are called to serve the church and I do it on a professional level. I live in church, I work in church, I walk church, I sleep church. You know, once upon a time when I saw this man, I go to church 7 a.m. and stay to work till 11. My wife would call me like, Eddie, you still at the church? I said, honey, you pray for this, right? You pray to marry a preacher, now I'm in church. But you know, you're in church, you pray. And let me tell you one thing, for those of us who serve, you know, in the church on a regular basis, when you meet people, talk to them, your emotional status keeps going up and down. You meet happy people, they're talking about getting married, child graduation, birthday party, and you meet somebody else where the family's breaking up, there is death. So as you interact with people, you know, you yourself live through that. So there would be time I would come home and my wife would say, Eddie, the kids and I are waiting for you, for us to pray. I said, baby, I've been praying all day. Y'all go on and pray. It's like a lady that I worked with who was a bookkeeper, right? She was a professional accountant. And so one day I asked her, I said, who paid the bills at your house? She said, not me. I can't do it at work and then go home and do it. My husband does that. So the point I'm making is, those of us who are in church every day and people see us as ministers, yeah, it's easy for us to tell folks out there about following Jesus. The challenge is, how do we communicate that message to those who are closest to us? To my own child. Or maybe to my wife. I said, let me check again. I know she brought me to Jesus. Or my son. God bless me. I was able to baptize both kids. We encourage them to read the Bible. Tell them about Jesus. Yes, I know. But that's the responsibility we have. So my question to you and challenge and encouragement is, how are those who are closest to you? Do they know Jesus? Andrew, the first thing he did. First thing he found his brother. I'm not going to anybody else. My brother and I, we've been hoping. So, it may be a child, grandchild. Do they know Jesus? If you were to leave them in this world today, close your eyes to be with the Lord, will you meet them where you spend eternity? That's the question. Simon found his brother. He told him, we have found the Messiah. So Paul had that same desire. In Romans chapter 9, verse 1 and 2. So Paul now is a follower of Jesus. He knows what it means to be saved by grace. Not of works, not because of your good deeds. Salvation is free. It's all because of the finished work of Christ on Calvary. He died for our sins once and for all so that we would not be bringing sheep and goats to make sacrifices. So Paul in Romans chapter 9, verse 1, he says, I speak the truth in Christ. I am not lying. My conscience confirms it through the Holy Spirit. I have great sorrow and unceasing anguish in my heart. For I could wish that I myself were cursed and cut off from Christ for the sake of my people. Paul said, I know what it means to be a believer. I know what eternity will look like. Yeah. Until Elijah and Hannah, our son adopted their son Marlo. Yeah. Well, I read about adoption in the Bible, as Paul talks about it in the book of Romans. It was just a theoretical matter, right? But when Elijah them adopted Marlo, and I was the first to go visit and see him and where he was and the preparation they started making to get him here from Liberia to here, and all of what I knew about where he was and where he's going to be and the preparation they made, it helped me to internalize and personalize what Paul said when God adapted us into his family. Because that little boy did not know that there was a car waiting here with a car seat cut out all by himself. I mean, for himself, there was a room where he lived in an orphanage with other kids. Now he's going to have his own bed, his own room. Listen up. Not knowing what heaven has for us, but when you understand what it means that when you become a child of God, all of heaven is available to you. Paul said, I'm praying that my own people, my brothers, my sisters, your mama. There was a guy who passed a church to us, next door to us. He said when he was growing up, he used to sell drugs. He sold drugs with his own mom. Because that's what he knew. But when he came to know Jesus, he went back to that mom and said, Mama, I brought you the wrong thing. Now I have something that means more to me than drugs. I want to tell you about Jesus. So he wants all of us, each of us. When your children are young, the Bible says bring up a child in a way they're young. You know, as a Christian parent, you need to know how to share the gospel with your own babies. Because if you miss that, somebody else will be selling something else to them. So Paul said, for I could wish that I myself were cursed and cut off from Christ for the sake of my people, those my own race, the people of Israel. So he said, God's giving them so much. You know, when I was in seminary, there was a man called Peter Wagner. He wrote a lot about church growth, how to grow your church, how to grow your church. And one of the things, principles to talk about is a homogeneous, in heterogeneous principle, you know, people of the same color, same kind, you know, you reach them and all that. No, I mean, that's important in our community, especially the world in which we live in Birmingham, in America. You always have black churches that have white churches. And then you have the brave ones. We'll cross and come and worship together. Now, the thing that I've noticed about black church and white church, the songs, we sing them different ways. You sing Amazing Grace, you know, in the white church is different, in the black church is different. So, you know, I mean, that's good thing, you know, about both congregations. If we are able to come together to celebrate Christ, that's fine. But so God has sent us to reach our people. Paul said, my own people, my own race. Do you know any black boy, girl, woman, or man who does not know Jesus? What are you going to do about that? Do you know somebody in your family who does not know Jesus? I have many in my family right now who I'm not sure they know Jesus. I'm praying for them regularly. I mean, those of you who know me, you know, I come from a village. I go back. One time the Lord sent me back there, and he told me that my people were in deep spiritual darkness. Yeah. Is it still? Yes, but we are working at it. One soul at a time. Yes, one soul at a time. I was watching this movie. It's called Hacksaw Ridge. Hacksaw Ridge is a military about Vietnam. I mean, no, yeah. Hong Kong, where the Okushima and all that, and all the war is going on, but there is this guy, I've forgotten the name of this hero in the story. He was, when he signed up to go to the military, he knew he wasn't going to shoot anybody to kill anybody. He wasn't going to fire a gun, but that's where he wanted to be. Now, his assignment was, you know, when all his friends made mockery of him and everything, when the war got real tough, he was a praying man. He would go to rescue wounded soldiers. He would bring one and let them down, and then he said, one more. And then he'll go back into enemy territory and say, one more wounded person, bring them, let them down, and say, one more. That's what God has called us to be. There are people dying around. Let me let you know this. People are dying. We send missionaries from here to other countries. Listen, we are in the mission field right here where we said 35235, and in Birmingham, there is somebody on their way from God today, only if you don't tell them. Now, how do I know? Where can I find people? So when you flip over to Romans chapter 10, Paul says something again. Brothers and sisters, in verse 1, my heart's desire and prayer to God for Israel is that they will be saved. It starts with praying for your folks. You pray for them. You make a list. Make a list of those in your family that you are not sure about their salvation. And you pray. You talk to God first. Talk to God in private. Talk to God. Say, God, I love my brother. I love my sister. I love my mom. Love my daughter. I want them to know you. So that's Paul's first desire. Pray. Pray that they will be saved. Pray that they will be saved. And of course, and when you come to Romans chapter 10, verse 14, he said, those who believe in Jesus, after you pray, if they believe, they will be saved. They will have eternal life. So the question he asks is, verse 14, how then can they call on the one they have not believed in? People have to believe in Jesus to trust. And then he goes on to say, and how can they believe in the one of whom they have not heard? That's where we come in. Jesus said, go make disciples, right? It's like, go and preach. In Mark, he said, go and preach. You might say, well, I'm not a preacher. No, that's not what he's saying. Just basic communication, conversation. You know, like we are talking, you go to lunch, you meet with somebody, you tell them where they live, or you sell insurance, you know, you ask them, you know, if the insurance guy that, you know, sold life insurance, I mean, like, hey, brother, have you thought about your family? If something happened to you today, what's going to happen to your wife? Mm-hmm. So first, you create that fear factor, right? Yeah. That's a reality. If you don't do anything. So when you are talking to those people about Jesus, it's the same thing. Where will you spend eternity? But how do I know when to talk to someone, where to go? That's where the Holy Spirit comes in. You know, that's where the Holy Spirit comes in. So the Holy Spirit might not get up, wake you up in the morning and say, hey, you know, go down to Brewster Road. Yeah, sometimes God can do it. Go down to Brewster Road, you know, to the filling station and talk to the clerk over there. You know, she's from Kenya. Tell her about Jesus. Maybe the way God would do it is I put my eye on the dashboard and my gas light is on. You're about to run out of gas. You better go buy gas. Yeah. I know my wife, when that light comes on, geez, she'd be like, Eddie, if I'm in the car with you and your car breaks down because there's no gas, I'm crossing the street. I don't want anybody to associate me with you for you not putting gas in your car, because for her, half tank is empty tank. So when my gas light comes on, I go to the filling station. There might be somebody on the other side filling the gas, and then they turn, want to look at me and talk, don't want to talk, and then I give a smile, we start a conversation. Get to know where they're from, what they do. If they, you know, want to stay a little longer, like a lady and I, we talk on Saturday, she goes to church and her daughter is serving as missionary in one country. We spend like 5 minutes just talking. People want to talk. People want someone who can listen. People want to tell their story. Give them room to tell their story. How do I know? Talk to Jesus and the woman in John chapter 4. You know, she comes for water. Come for water doing what? When the sun is hot, 93 degrees, 93. Who want to come in the open for water, 93 degrees? Who don't want to be with their friends? But guess what? She had a bad situation. You read the story before? Been married 5 times. Most of the girls in the community don't like her. They don't want to associate with her. In fact, John said, Jesus said, you have another man in your house who's not your husband. Maybe he was one of those girls, somebody. So there's conflict, there's tension in the community. But she had a need. God loved her. And so Jesus is going to go through Samaria, not because, you know, Jesus didn't have anything to do, but God was setting up a divine appointment. And God will bring people your way. Not by accident, on the job where God placed you. In the hospital, wherever you go in your community, it may be a child, grandchild, somebody leave their child with you. Listen, use that as an opportunity to talk about what matters most in this life. Jesus said, you know, she saw Jesus and not supposed to talk to a man and all that. And Jesus just started a simple conversation, man, can you give me some water? If you say, I don't know how to talk, Moses tried to play that joke on God. God said, go to Pharaoh. You went to school. Moses is a military general. He was trained to lead an army. He said, God, I can't talk. God said, I'll set you up. Your brother can talk. Y'all go on. Yeah. So where do I find people? Everywhere you go. Now, if you're not praying for somebody's salvation, it becomes difficult for it to be important to you. You have to stop and pray. Pray that God will lift somebody on your heart. Pray that God will save somebody. Pray that God will send somebody your way. It's the urgency with which we treat it. That's what will bring people to Jesus. He said we are salt, right? Yes. Salt is to purify stuff. But salt is to also make you thirsty. You remember those stuff when we used to go to the cinema, you go buy the popcorn, large size popcorn, and you kind of start, chipping on it and then on it. That's a lot of salt in there, right? The goal is, after you eating popcorn, I'm not talking to you, Miss Coretta, for you to go and buy some Coke. So the popcorn, the salt make you thirsty. And so if people see the salt in your life, they will want to know when you're going through difficulties and the doctor just wrote you off and they said you have 6 months to live or you just got a letter, no job, and your husband just walked away. They can see your smile. You can sing Amazing Grace. Guess what? Say, what is it about you, lady? You're making them thirsty. It's that personal story that will draw people. It's not the quoting of the John 3:16, for God so loved the world. It's, lady, listen to me. I mean, I was down and out. My backs were to the ground, but Jesus came. So when that Samaritan woman, after she talked with Jesus and went back, when she said, come see a man, they said, sister, we believe you. Because we know your story. And if that God knows your story, there must be something about him that transcends our community. It's a personal story. This is my story. This is my song. Praise him, my Savior, all the day long. Because, listen up. When I left my village, I only left my village because Dad pushed me out. He wanted his kids to learn to read and write. Read and write. I'm not saying learn, you know, trigonometry, to read and write. But in the process of finding ways to read and write, I met Jesus. I met Jesus at a critical time in my life. I met Jesus in 1980. 1980, we had a military coup. I'm in 10th grade. I'm 20 years old. Education has become like religion for me. I left my village to go to school. I went to school with no shoes. I stole uniform to go to school. I'm confessing to this. I stole a boy's uniform just to be in school. It was everything. Then the military government comes and they say all schools will be closed. We had a wonderful principal. She was kind. She called us that day. She said, children, we've never seen this before in our lifetime, in our country, for a military to take over government, and it's not going to be pretty in the streets. I will encourage you all to go home and wait and see how things will turn out. If it's okay, you'll come back to school. And I'm going home from school, and I said, I can't miss one day from school. Listen, I never missed day. I did not want to miss day from school because one of the teachers could explain to me what I needed to hear. And I made a commitment to myself. I said, if I don't go to school before this year ends, whoever's responsible, their children's children will never go to school. And you might be asking me, what do you have? I come from a place that is still in deep spiritual darkness. So we went home. But God, in his divine grace, it was that same year, 1980, that he touched my heart. So that my life would not be involved in deep spiritual things, darkness. But I had to turn to the gospel of Christ, because if I had not gone to school, I was going back to my village, going back to my people, going back to whatever they did. But God said, you know, I can use you in a better way. So you have to pray. You have to ask God to show you how to witness to people, where to find them. So believers like Andrew, think about those who are closest to you. They're the most difficult to work with too, because they know you. How do I know? Our own Savior Jesus, when he was in the flesh, his brother James and the other brothers are like, this guy is crazy. Yeah. They thought something was wrong with Jesus. They did not believe in him. In fact, they kept pushing him like, well, people want to see you. You said you were the Messiah. Go show yourself. But what turned was when Jesus was crucified, and after the resurrection, James had a turn around. He surrendered his life, and he became the first bishop of the church in Jerusalem. Don't give up on those who are closest to you. No matter how much time you pray for them, you witness to them. Some people in your life, you will not see them come to faith until maybe when God calls you. Mm-hmm. I grew up with a young man who, we sang in the choir. We have fun, went on youth camp and all that stuff. We come to choir rehearsal, youth choir rehearsal, you just be distracting everybody. Our young director is helping us, all about the same age, but he didn't care until his mother died. Then when his mother died, I went to Liberia. I saw the brother with a Bible on his... And I'm going like, what? Hey, brother, what's going on? He said, oh, I feel called to ministry. I said, thank you, Jesus. He's a wonderful pastor. He's in Texas. The brother can speak. He can write. But when his mama was alive, he did not show any sign about Jesus. So some people in your life will not come to church, but don't give up praying for them. You know, St. Augustine, you know, that we read about, St. Augustine of Hippo, he said, a child of many prayers will never be lost. St. Augustine went to seminary. He had a hunger in his heart, emptiness in his heart for godliness. They said while he was in seminary, he used to chase girls. But, you know, his mom kept praying for him until one day while he was sitting in the garden, and God is a good God. A page of the Bible, Romans chapter 1, was ripped off from somebody's Bible, and it was flying in the air. And while he was sitting there, the Spirit said, tick and read. Let me read that and wrap this up. Romans chapter 1, 17. There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the gospel we have to preach. Power to save. He said, Paul start with this verse, 16. For I am not ashamed of the gospel, because it is the power of God to bring salvation to everyone who believes. First to the Jews and then to the Gentiles. The good news is for everyone. If religion was a thing that money could buy, so the rich would live and the poor would die. But somebody said, thank God Almighty that he made it so that the rich and the poor together must live. So he sent Jesus. But look at verse 17 that caught St. Augustine's attention and drew him to Christ. He said, for in the gospel, the righteousness of God is revealed. A righteousness that is by faith from first to last. As it is written, the righteous, the just shall live by faith. This guy was a monk. He was a priest. They were doing everything physically to get peace from God. You know, fasting and, you know, staying hungry and being locked up in a closed room. It's not all that. Jesus saved. He gave his life for you. If he invites you into your life, you will be saved. That's what the Bible says. If you believe. And so, like Andrew, BRCC, it is our obligation to tell someone about Jesus. This is our season to witness, to bear personal testimony. Personal testimony. That's what somebody want to see, personal testimony. That's what they want to hear. But not quoting Isaiah 55 chapter. No. Tell them that, you know, Jesus saved you. Yeah. I mean, I always tell this story. It's simple. My wife gets tired hearing it. But girls make good evangelists. Women make good evangelists. If a man is in love with a woman, listen up, baby. If you hold fast to Jesus, if you tell that man jump, he will say, how high? If he's in love with you and want to love, serve the Lord. Because I went to my girlfriend's house for one more time after she invited me to church, and I gave all the excuses. I don't have clothes to wear to church. In fact, I don't even know the people in the church. You know, were they welcoming, blah, blah, blah. And this day she just said, hey, baby. If you don't want to come to church, you need to stop coming to my house. I said, what? She said, oh, yeah, she was serious. But you know how God fixed it for me? Her stepmom, when I went in the house, would tell her stepmom, hey, mom, see you next time. She said, oh, Eddie, do you want to come to church? I was like, okay. Now I got to come back to the lady's house. I can't say no. That was the beginning of a new day for me. From that time since I went to church, you know, my friends in my community would joke me like, oh, he's going to go to church because his girlfriend goes to the church. But I'm glad I went there because my girlfriend is there. I know Jesus. I have peace of mind. I mean, I don't have the riches of this world, but I have Jesus. I know where I would spend eternity. I know that God loved me. He's promised to be faithful. So, what's about those who are closest to you? The first place to start, pray for them. Don't harass them with the gospel, pray for them. Don't make them feel the worst sinners, pray for them. And love them. You know, Peter said to those women who asked in his time, you know, who were married to men who were not Christians, said, should we leave our husbands? Said, no, baby. You got bills to pay. You need somebody else to talk to when you get home. If the guy wants to be there. Now, what you can do is live for Jesus. Not in fine clothes, not showing jewelry, not showing beautiful hair, not the best of cologne, but the inner character of who you are. Love them, serve them, be kind. Hey, that's how you draw people to Jesus. Let me stop right there because we got to go home. Tell someone our season to witness. Tell someone about Jesus. I don't know about you this morning, but when I came to church, when I was coming, we prayed this morning that if somebody's here who's hearing this message does not know Jesus, we pray that they will give their life to Jesus. If you're here this morning, if you don't know what it means to be a Christian, honestly, that's why we're here to help you. Listening, you can talk to somebody closest to you. We also pray that, you know, this church with all these empty pews, we need workers. We pray that somebody will find the faith to join this church. To put a name on the book, on the roll, and say, I'm here to work, to serve, to let God use me to bring somebody else into his kingdom. Will there be one today, folks? I'm not too good on invitation, all that stuff. Because let me tell you my true story. When I came to know Jesus, I was sitting in my seat when Jesus spoke to me. Nobody knew but me and Jesus. Right there. And then after some time, you know, I started walking out drip, drip. But some people need that encouragement. He said, one today, give your life to Jesus. Be a part of this fellowship. If so, the door is open. The door is open. May God bless us. May he guide. May he give us courage and boldness. Like the early church, they pray for boldness. If you don't have it, pray for that. And God will give it to you. Amen. Let me pray for us. Father God, in the name of Jesus, we thank you. We bless you. We love you, Lord. We have shared your word, your story, your command to us. To make disciples, to tell people about you, to be witnesses unto you. God, I pray for courage in this house. I pray for boldness. I pray for clarity of mind. I pray for confidence. As you go this week, God, lead somebody my way. Lead somebody our way. Show us the person who needs Jesus. And God, help us to be ready to share our faith. In Jesus' name. Amen. And amen. Let's give Jesus some praise. Hallelujah. And hallelujah. And hallelujah. We thank you, Lord. I think we are going to do the communion, right? And who's doing that? There you go. Come on. Evander.
This is a very sacred moment in our service where we get to participate in the Lord's Supper. So we ask that we would just prepare our hearts, bow our heads for a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for what our eyes have seen and our ears have heard through your word. We thank you for the conviction of our pastor and the power in which he's delivered the word. And because of that, Lord God, we trust and believe that someone has come to the saving faith of knowing who you are. And for those of us who've already made that confession, now we come because we are in relationship with you, God, to sup with you. We ask, God, that you would bless the elements of the table, that we would realize that we're in relationship with you, and that there is nothing that we need that you will not provide, because everything we need is in you. We ask you to cleanse our hearts from all unrighteousness and make us fit to receive your body and your blood. It is in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. 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 And he will not change. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Has everyone been served? Amen. Hallelujah. The Bible says on the night in which the Lord was betrayed, that he took bread, he gave thanks, and he broke it. He said, "This is my body, which is broken for you. Take, let's eat together." And in like manner, he took the cup, gave thanks, and said, "This is my blood, which is the new covenant, which is shed for you for the remission of sins. Take, let's drink together." And the word declares that they sung a hymn and went out. We ask right now that you would just take a moment to reflect on your covenant relationship with God and let him speak to you. Rest in his presence and receive what you need from him.
Good morning, everyone. We bless God for being a good, good Father who is perfect in all of his ways. Amen. I will bring announcements this morning. First announcement is that if you look in the back of the seats, there is QR codes that you can use for your giving. It does not mean that this is taking the place of traditional means of giving. So if you are not tech savvy, then please feel free to do a check or cash or whatever other means. But for those of you that are tech savvy and maybe like me, don't carry cash or anything, then there's a QR code in the back of the seat that you can use for your giving. Amen. BRCC is in the process of starting a new medical ministry that will be headed by Sister Janice Johnson. And so we're asking for donations for that. Also, our culinary and prayer and care teams are also in need of volunteers. If you are interested in serving in any of these ministries, then please contact the church office at officemanager@brccbham.info. Also, some important dates and upcoming events. Our monthly fast will start on April 28th and end on May 5th. So if you guys remember, we do a monthly fast the very last week of every month, the last week going into the first week of every month. And so for this month, it is the 28th through the 5th. It is up to you how you fast and what you fast. Just make sure that whatever commitment you make before God, you make it before God. Amen. Y'all quiet this morning. Okay, number two, BRCC will be celebrating our 12th church anniversary on May 5th. So we are ending our fast on our 12th anniversary. Join us and invite a friend as we celebrate the faithfulness of our God. Please remember that May 12th is also Mother's Day. And so remember to celebrate your mom, either biological, adopted, or just spiritual mom, for all that she has done and all that she does. On May 19th, we will have our second quarter potluck celebrating birthdays occurring in April, May, and June. If you are feeling called to the ministry on January 2nd through the 12th of 2025, Pastor Gibson will be leading a mission team to Marshall City, Liberia. We will be providing medical services and dedicating the mission house that is currently being built along those same lines. We ask that you continue to pray for the mission house and also pray for the construction that is going on in the village. Please join us on Wednesday nights for Recharge Bible Study. Doors open at 6:15. Prayer start at 6:30 and Bible study at 6:45. We try to wrap up around 7:30, but forgive me because sometimes we go a little bit over. Amen. Along those same lines, Pastor has already mentioned, but next Wednesday, the first Wednesday in May, we will be starting The Insanity of God. So you still have a couple of more days, if you've not finished the book, to go ahead and read up. If you don't have the book and would like a copy, please let us know. You can check out a copy, and then once you're finished reading it, you can return the copy, or once we're finished studying it. At this time, we want to wish all of you who are celebrating birthdays and anniversaries this month a very happy birthday and happy anniversary. And little Sam, where's little Sam? JB, happy birthday, JB. So those of you that hadn't wished him a happy birthday, please wish him happy birthday. We are very excited to see Sister Precious in the house also, his mommy. Amen. If this is your first time at BRCC, please connect with us. Our greeters have visitor cards that you can fill out. You can also click on the Connect with BRCC QR code that's on the back of your seats to tell us more about yourself. And remember, we like to believe that here at BRC is a place where you matter, each and every one of you matter. Congratulations are in order for Dr. Ja'Kayla Stone, who became a doctor of physical therapy. Oh, thank you. See, she's at work. I didn't realize she was putting announcements on the screen. So congratulations, Dr. Ja'Kayla Stone, a doctor of physical therapy on yesterday, April 20th. We are also congratulating Sister Edie Gibson,
amen,
who will become a doctor of dental medicine on May 10th.
Amen.
Edie has asked that you save the date of May 25th to celebrate with her. More details to follow at a later date. And if any of you guys remember, most of you remember that both Ja'Kayla and Edie, this wasn't like a cakewalk for either one of them. You know, they both had their individual struggles and their individual things that they had to overcome, but they made it. Amen. 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 We have five, I believe, that are graduating high school this May. We have Madison Broadnack on the 22nd from Clay Chalkwell High School. We also have Jeremy Billingsley on the 22nd from Clay Chalkville. We have Matthew Yafundo on May 23rd from Fulton High School. And we have Michael Porter from Ramsey High School. I don't have the date. What's Michael's date? 27th? May 27th from Ramsey High School. Amen. If there are any other accomplishments that we did not, because I know we have some college students that are graduating that have not been mentioned also. So if there are any other accomplishments that we have, then please let us know. Amen. And then as Pastor comes up, I'm just going to take the opportunity to say a very heartfelt thank you to all of those that traveled to Montgomery yesterday to be with my family and I as we celebrated Kayla's graduation. And thank all of you.